Well, hi, everyone. Thanks for tuning in to the Dr. Joe Galati podcast, broadcasting high above the Texas Medical Center in Houston, purveyor of all things related to the liver, health and wellness, nutrition, food and cooking, and all-around doctor banter and witty repartee with our experts that visit us. Our website is drjoegalati.com. If you'd like to send me a note, subscribe to our newsletter, or even see me as a patient. If you want to call and be part of the program, dial us at 888-438-9431. And now, on with the podcast.
Coming to you live from Houston, Texas, home to the world's largest medical center. This is Your Health First, the most beneficial health program on radio with Dr. Joe Galati. During the next hour, you'll learn about health, wellness, and the prevention of disease. Now, here's your host, Dr. Joe Galati.
Well, a good Sunday evening to everybody. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. Thanks for spending an hour with us. We are here every single Sunday evening between 7 and 8 p.m., something around 17 years we've been doing this, and it really, for me, is part of the, you know, the best hour of the week for me. Now, on the program tonight, Howard Huang. He is the relatively new medical director of the lung transplant program at Houston Methodist Hospital right here in the Texas Medical Center. And I want him to come in not only to talk about those indications for a lung transplant, which really is end-stage lung disease, but some of the more common things we could talk about to, you know, what you can do to keep your lungs healthy. So Dr. Huang is in the studio tonight. He'll be on in a little while. And also go to the website, www.drjoegalati.com. Sign up for our newsletter. Everything we're talking about tonight is on the website. All right. So hopefully you had a great Sunday. The weather, it was horrible towards the end of the week, and it warmed up pretty nicely. Hopefully you had a chance to go out and exercise. I did exercise this weekend, went to a farmer's market this afternoon, bought some fresh cauliflower, some fresh beets, and spinach. So I've got my vegetables for the next few days lined up. One thing I want to chat about this segment is one little saying that I have, and if you're a patient of mine, I say this at least a dozen times a day. Eating out is a hazard to your health. And people look at me and they say, really? And I am convinced that so much of the obesity and heart disease and fatty liver and hypertension that we see is directly related to eating. Hence, I felt that way enough to write a book about it. But last evening, my wife and I, we were toying around with, cooking at home, which is what we do the vast majority of the time. And she had said, well, maybe we could cook at home on Sunday and maybe we should go out. And I said, well, and I tend to be not a picky eater, like I don't eat certain things. I am picky on where I go to eat to, in a sense, strive for healthful food. And so we went back and forth and we arrived at going to this Italian restaurant, which we have eaten at a few times before. I said, but I'm very concerned that their dishes all tend to be very creamy and cheesy and things that I just don't like that are not good for you. So as we were driving there, she pulled up the menu on her phone, and she went through a couple of things, and there was this one dish, which was garlic, olive oil, broccoli, in a with a the pasta was a more of a shell. And I said, okay, there you go. Minimal, if any, cheese, olive oil, lots of garlic, and a vegetable. I said, okay, I could eat that and not feel too guilty. Well, we ordered it and it came out not made properly to my standards. Now, what the heck are my standards? Well, back in the kitchen, they must have added flour as some sort of a thickener or thickening element to it. And this was a pasty, high calorie, high carb, more carbs than I had anticipated kind of a dish. And I ate maybe a third of it. And as I was eating it, I'm saying, this is not a healthful meal. So what I thought was olive oil, garlic, and a vegetable with some pasta turned into something that I did not really enjoy. Now, some may call me a food snob. Not in a bad way. My food is better than your food. I think my job as a physician, seeing patients and here on the radio, is to make everybody aware that you have to take more interest and more concern in what you're eating. Now, because we're not eating at home, which is the truth, we simply accept what is dished out. We have lost our ability to discern a healthful meal from an unhealthy meal. And you all have to make that connection of what we eat. Are you trying to appreciate the flavor, the taste, the nutritional value, or lack thereof, and how it ties back to your own health and wellness? We are in a society where we eat and don't put any thought into it. So really, you know, what's the message for tonight? Keep in mind, and I'll go back to the beginning, eating out is a hazard to your health. You will order food and think that it's a bargain because they're giving you a lot and all the cheese, and look, this is a bargain, look how much I could eat. And we're losing sight of how it is made. What are the ingredients? What's the portion size? Is it oversalted? Is it overcheesed? And until we get to that point, we're still going to have problems with obesity and all of its downhill complications. And I don't have to say it again, but I will. Heart disease, hypertension, kidney disease, fatty liver, diabetes, nerve damage, stroke, heart attack, cancer. And so, you know, am I never going to go out and eat again? Well, it just reinforces. I told my wife, we're never going back here again. It's just one of those things. Eating out is a hazard. You all have to be careful. And if we could just eat more at home, I think we'd all be better off. All right, we're going to take a break right now. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. Don't forget, go to drjoegalati.com. Dr. Howard Huang will be coming up talking about lung disease in a little while. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody. Dr. Joe Galati, this is Your Health First, every Sunday between 7 and 8 p.m. Don't forget, go to drjoegalati.com, drjoegalati.com. Oh, music cut off pretty short. Josh, what happened? All right, he leaned, short bed, all right, no problem. All right, what I wanted to do here is talk about some things in the news. There is a columnist with the New York Times, Anahad O'Connor. And as I've said before, he is an up-and-coming writer for them. And he sticks in the nutrition, food, exercise space. He wrote an absolutely outstanding article about exercise. And I believe the New York Times has taken off the requirement for you to be a subscriber to get this article. It is comprehensive in that it talks about strength training. And I looked at it, and I was at the gym yesterday and today going through the various exercises. This is almost a no-brainer. If you want to get in shape with strength training, either at a gym or at home, this really is for you. I believe I posted it on our Facebook page. If not, I will after the program tonight. But it is an excellent resource for people of all ages to look at with regard to some strength training and how to follow a program. It really is pretty good. There's another article that came across my desk this week, and it has to do with tainted supplements. And this is forever an ongoing problem. And so the article, it is, when you read it, I've got it right here, it is absolutely scary because there are, and the majority of these are for male sexual enhancement. And the commercial will say, all natural. All right? Our special formulation, all natural. But what they're not telling you is that it has Viagra and Cialis in it. And so this is a huge problem. And so what is happening? People are poisoning themselves. And so what happens is a man is having some erectile dysfunction problem. He is embarrassed. He does not want to go to his doctor. He doesn't want to tell anybody. But he sees an ad for a natural supplement. Who wouldn't try this? And so they try it. They're getting all kinds of garbage herbs and whatnot, and just a touch of Cialis, just a touch of Viagra. And that is not good. Now, at the same time, there are men that are going to their doctor and saying, I would like a prescription for Viagra. And the doctor says, no, Bob. You've got a bad heart. Maybe you've got bad lung disease, and Dr. Huang could comment on that. But there's something wrong with you where I do not believe you should be taking Viagra or Cialis. It's like, okay, so what do? You buy the supplement, the natural supplement. But it also has Viagra in it, which you do not know about. These are compounds that are not controlled by the FDA. And it is a problem. Other weight loss products have all sorts of medications that have been taken off the market. They contain antidepressants, Prozac, and this is a story that just will not go away. These companies are still out there. So once again, it is buyer beware. You have to be very, very careful. Now, here's another article from the New York Times. Is eating deli meat really bad for you? All right, everybody, you know, loves their deli meat. I tell my patients, do not eat deli meat because of the high salt content. So this is an interesting statistic here by the American Institute for Cancer Research. We see a 4% increase in the risk of cancer even at 15 grams of the deli meat, which is a slice of ham. One slice, says the director of research for the American Institute for Cancer Research. Eating a more typical serving of 50 grams, which is about a standard sandwich, increases the risk of colorectal cancer by 18%. Based on a 2011 review. Now, they're saying red meat, there is a link with colorectal cancer. But as the Cancer Institute is saying, it advises people to limit red meat, but avoid processed meat. Avoid. That means none, nil, zip. So what are processed meats? Just so we're all on the same page here. It refers to any meat, including pork, poultry, lamb, goat, or others that have been salted, smoked, cured, fermented, or otherwise processed for preservation or enhancement of flavor. This includes hot dogs, ham, bacon, turkey, corned beef, pepperoni, salami, smoked turkey, bologna, and other lunch and deli meats, sausage, corned beef, and beef jerky, canned meat, and meat-based preparations and sauces, amongst others. You're probably sitting there saying, oh my God, what are we going to eat? Well, eat something a little bit more natural and plant-based. All right, two last things. I don't watch too much TV, but every so often I see these ads for things that make me want to get sick. All right, so there's this one thing called Zona Plus. Dr. Huang, you could just nod your head. Have you ever seen that commercial? No, he's never seen it. Okay, we got 2 minutes, right? Okay. So Zona Plus, one of the guys that is on the TV show, The Doctors, is representing them. It is for $599, you get an isometric hand grip that is supposed to lower blood pressure. Now, I see this, and I say, for all these people out there that have hypertension, maybe a little diabetes, some kidney disease, you're saying, hey, Harriet, I don't want to take medicine. I'm going to go buy this gadget, and I'll lower my blood pressure because this guy is a TV doctor. It's FDA. It's not FDA approved. All these people are claiming that it's excellent. Again, buyer beware. This is, to me, a bit of a hoax. I can't believe that your rank and file person with high blood pressure is just going to buy this, let alone at $600. But, you know, beware. The other thing is another commercial on Golo for Life. This is a weight loss supplement. It is a number of herbs, and it claims that it controls your diabetes naturally. What they don't tell you is that they want you to follow a diet. And oh, by the way, take this supplement. $60 a month for this. You could buy a lot of organic spinach for $60. All right, coming up after the break, Dr. Howard Huang, Medical Director of the Lung Transplant Program at Houston Methodist. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. Stay tuned. Welcome back, everybody. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. Every Sunday between 7 and 8 p.m., trying to raise your health IQ one listener at a time. And as I've been talking about early in the evening, it is a great honor to have Dr. Howard Huang. He is the medical director of the lung transplant program at Houston Methodist Hospital and the J.C. Walter Jr. Transplant Center, new member of the family here. Howard, thanks for coming in tonight and your maiden appearance on Your Health First.
Well, great. This is exciting. Thank you very much for the invitation.
Oh, absolutely. And there's so much with regard to lung disease and all the different facets to chat about. So first, lung disease. How did you get into this? What's your passion for going into lung disease?
Well, I first became interested as a when I was doing my training in internal medicine, and I just kind of gravitated towards these patients who were really desperately ill with respiratory illnesses that were in the intensive care unit.
Mm-hmm.
This is where you have the really excitement of being able to turn somebody's severe pneumonia around and get them past this life-threatening illness. And that was kind of the beginnings of my interest. And then the physiology and kind of the broad categories of lung disease that are involved really kind of drew me into it.
Yeah. You know, a question that I ask all the various specialists that come in here is, because I put so much weight into communicating with the patient, with their family and caretakers, and that is a big chunk of what we do with our patients besides intervening and doing various procedures and medical therapies. But from your perspective, when patients come to you, and maybe they're a new patient or it's a new diagnosis that you provide them with, what is your sense as far as the general understanding of lung disease when you start talking about the symptoms or the treatments? Where are the general public at?
I think that's an area that really needs a lot of education in general, because breathing or just lung health is one of these things that most of us take for granted.
Right.
You don't think about having to take, most people without lung disease don't think about taking that next breath or think about how hard I'm working to breathe.
Yeah.
It's not a conscious thing for the vast majority of people who otherwise don't have lung disease.
Right. Do a lot of patients, when they come and they're lamenting of a certain symptom, which we'll get into in a few minutes, is there the sense that a light went off to say, gee, this is abnormal and I shouldn't be short of breath for, getting up from the kitchen table to drop my plate off? Are we at that level or, the degree of sophistication, I guess, in the patients that not only you see, but, the general pulmonologist sees? What's the sense out there?
Well, I think it really depends on the patient and how attuned they are to how they're feeling from day to day. And for example, so somebody who runs regularly, it's going to notice that they're having some impairment much sooner than somebody who is largely sedentary.
Yeah.
They're not going to really pick up on shortness of breath. Maybe traveling or going to a different setting, like, for example, going to altitude and suddenly being completely gassed.
Right, right.
That's a hint that there's something going on.
Would you say there is one common question that patients or their caretakers will ask you about their lung problem?
I think that the biggest thing that people want to know is what does the future hold? What's
right.
the prognosis? Is this something, and is it going to get better? Is there something we can do to make things better?
Yeah. Well, okay, let's get into a few things for everybody listening tonight. In everybody that comes in here with me, we want you all, the listeners, the fans of Your Health First, to really expand your knowledge and understand. Because if you, the listener, you, the general public, are unaware of these symptoms, then you're not going to connect the dots and say, wait a second, this is wrong. So Howard, what are some of the common symptoms that somebody with a lung problem may report?
Yeah, so that's a good question. There are several things. One is just the sensation of shortness of breath, especially mm-hmm. when you exert yourself. And this usually becomes more prevalent or something that really comes to the forefront, something that you really notice as the disease progresses. And a lot of times, one of the problems is that people kind of minimize their symptoms.
Right.
They think, maybe I'm just out of shape because I haven't been working out. I'm getting older. That's what the normal trend is. And
right.
This is nothing out of the ordinary. So they tend to minimize their symptoms.
Right.
Another common one is a cough that doesn't go away.
Right.
And a lot of times it's diagnosed as asthma or maybe bronchitis or, maybe some sort of infection. And, if you're having to be treated repeatedly for the same symptoms that do not resolve, that suggests there may be some sort of underlying problem.
Okay. What else?
And then, as I mentioned, kind of going to a different setting, so this kind of this dyspnea or shortness of breath at altitude, that's really kind of a warning signal.
Right.
That there's probably some problem because at altitude, you don't have the air is not as rich in oxygen. And a lot of times people with chronic lung disease, when they're taken to altitude, notice that. And that includes flying on commercial airlines.
So people with lung disease may get more symptomatic in a plane.
Yes, possibly.
Yeah. How about phlegm?
Phlegm, so chronic sputum production.
Sputum, right. Yeah.
And so that's one of these and it's normal to have that if you have some sort of acute viral infection. You pick up a cold, something like that. But
right.
That typically should get better. But if you're having it for months on end, kind of a chronic presentation of these symptoms, then that may also suggest that there's a problem.
Yeah. The other thing is the color of the phlegm, white, yellow, green, red. Mm-hmm. So, you know, again, I would think as the non-pulmonologist, a white phlegm is maybe not as bad, though it could be, as yellow or green. So what do you think?
That's true.
Prove me wrong. Prove me wrong here.
Well, it's hard to prove Dr. Galati wrong. But I think the thing that really alarms people, obviously, is if they cough up anything red that looks like blood. That triggers a major, you know, like a five-alarm scenario.
Right.
But usually, you know, if you're coughing up a lot of green or yellow sputum, that suggests there's chronic inflammation and maybe chronic infection in the airways. Some other diseases may be associated with chronic, you know, thick white sputum production, but you know, usually it should be clear and it shouldn't be an overwhelming amount. So if you find it, it's a huge amount. You know, you're filling up the bottom of an 8-ounce cup, for example.
Yeah,
that's above average, I would say.
Yeah, I would say I think you hit it on the head where people will minimize and people will, you know, liver patients that I'm seeing. We go through a little review and yes, they're short of breath and they say, well, you know, Dr. Galati, I just turned 50. You know, I haven't worked out in 3 years. And I'm like, no, you have fluid in your chest and that's why you're short of breath. This gets back to, you know, the understanding. Do patients connect the severity of or the implication of being short of breath or the implication of coughing with something more severe, or are they very nonchalant about it?
Well, I think it's one of these things that if it's chronic, then you become kind of desensitized to it over time.
Yeah.
Until the symptoms really drive you to seek medical care.
Right.
You know, and so, you know, over time, it you know, if things progress, then it gets to a point where you just can't deny it anymore.
Right. All right. So for clarity, true or false, shortness of breath needs to be brought to the attention of their primary care.
Yeah, I think you know, that's something that should come up in the conversation, especially if it's persistent or you know, something that isn't associated with a clear, you know, acute kind of episode, like having a cold or you know, kind of those sort of symptoms.
And I would say ditto with the chronic cough and phlegm and mucus.
Yes, that I would say so.
All right, good. All right, so that's excellent. What are some of the statistics on smoking? It seems like we've hit a plateau in the number of people smoking. And from what I'm reading and talking with people, there may be actually an increase in youth smoking. Is that true?
Yes. And that actually really has come to the forefront, you know, especially with the advent of these non-combustible nicotine delivery products. So these vapes. But you know, going back to the whole overall prevalence of smoking. So, you know, over the last 4 or 5 decades, we've really actually made some significant progress in getting people to stop smoking.
Right.
So I just looked this up before I came on, and apparently back in 1965, about 4 out of 10 people in general in the population smoked.
Right.
And the last CDC report that was released in 2017 indicated that cigarette smoking in adults has reached an all-time low in the United States. So we're talking around 14-15%.
Right. Okay.
So it's a substantial reduction over the decades.
Yeah.
But I think the problem now is that you have this new wave of devices that are resulting in people becoming addicted to nicotine.
Right.
And some of those are going to start smoking again.
Yeah.
So you potentially may reverse this trend over time if you have more people who are hooked on nicotine.
That's the problem. All right, we're going to take a break. We're with Dr. Howard Huang, director of the lung transplant program at Houston Methodist Hospital. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. This is Your Health First. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Final segment of Your Health First. I'm Dr. Joe Galati every Sunday between 7 and 8 p.m. All right, and everybody else, go to drjoegalati.com. And, of course, the book Eating Yourself Sick is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and lots of other online sources. All right, in the studio, we've been talking with Howard Huang, latest member of the J.C. Walter Jr. Transplant Center family. You enjoying yourself in Houston so far?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's a homecoming.
Right. It's a homecoming. Absolutely. You grew, born and raised here in Houston. So, all right. So let's, for the last, another minute or so, vaping. So for parents listening tonight, grandparents, coaches, teachers, or the youth, there's a false sense that vaping is okay. What do you think?
Well, I think for young people in particular, it is not okay. And the reason is because these are vehicles to nicotine addiction.
Right.
Some of these young people will then go on to smoke. And there was a recent JAMA article that came out showing that your likelihood of becoming a smoker if you vape as a teen is about 400% more than if you weren't.
Wow.
So this is really a setup for future tobacco and tobacco product dependence.
Right. So, you know, all I could say is if one of your kids is at home and they are vaping and you look at them and you say, well, oh, this is 1,000 times better than having a pack of Camels in their pocket. You would agree. Your opinion is it's better than smoking a cigarette.
Yeah, it's better, but it's certainly not
benign,
harmless.
And, yeah.
And the other thing to consider is that the chemical effects on a developing brain,
right,
which is not entirely understood, and there are many negative effects.
Right. All right. All right. So that's the other message for tonight. All right. So you were recruited to come to Houston Methodist to head up the lung transplant program, and a lot of people are in the dark about what a lung transplant program is all about. So why don't you tell everybody, who is it? Who is that patient that may need a lung transplant? Who is it that should think about a lung transplant, and what you and your team are able to fashion for these people?
Yes. So the lung transplant is a treatment option. It's not really a cure, but mm-hmm. it's an option for people who have very advanced lung disease. Usually these are people who have failed medical therapies, mm-hmm. or perhaps they have a condition that there is no medical therapy available. And they usually have gotten to the point where they become oxygen dependent, mm-hmm. And the disease is likely to result in an early demise. And so the lung transplant is a potential option that would hopefully not only extend somebody like this, extend their life, but also improve their quality of life.
Yeah. Now, what are the diseases, the conditions that they may have had for a good number of years that ultimately leads them to that end stage disease condition?
So the two leading indications for lung transplant these days are, pulmonary fibrosis. So these mm-hmm. are conditions that result in progressive scarring in the lungs that then lead to a loss of lung function and end-stage lung disease.
Mm-hmm.
The other major category is COPD. And so these are diseases that result in damage to the lung tissue and also the airways that prevent air from exiting the lung. So it's the O in COPD is obstructive.
Mm-hmm.
And these people usually suffer from very poor quality of life. They're very dyspneic or short of breath all the time, and some of them end up on oxygen. They would compose the second group, or largest group of transplant candidates.
Yeah. Now, for everybody listening tonight, I am sure there are people that are sitting there tonight and say, hey, I've got COPD. Do I need a lung transplant? Or they have COPD and they are traveling around with their little oxygen concentrator or tank of oxygen in their house. Hey, do I need a lung transplant? What is that line that people cross to say, you know, your rank and file guy with COPD versus the person that needs to be considered for a lung transplant?
So there's several kind of warning signs in people with COPD. Granted, not everybody with COPD needs a lung transplant,
right,
or should
mm-hmm.
be even considered for a lung transplant. Many people can be managed well with medical therapies, inhalers, medicines, things like that. One of the biggest things is to stop smoking. You have to
right.
stop the ongoing injury.
Vape either.
Right. Vaping doesn't. If vaping will help you stop smoking, maybe that's, you know, kind of an intermediate step.
Right.
But certainly you want to kind of stop inhaling noxious substances in your lungs.
Yeah.
About 90% of people with COPD have some sort of smoke exposure in the past, at least in the developed world. Now, in the developing world, then that's, you know, there's other sorts of exposures like, you know, cooking fires and things like that. But a lot of times this is a kind of an environmental exposure on top of perhaps genetic factors that then lead to COPD.
Right.
Now, the people with COPD who need to be considered for transplant are the ones that are ending up in the hospital for an exacerbation, a flare-up. You know, ones that can't maintain the weight. They're spending so much energy breathing that they are losing weight. You know, people who are deteriorating functionally, ending up in a wheelchair and immobile.
Right.
Progressively debilitated. Yeah, those are people that are not going to do well with COPD.
Yeah, these are people that their quality of life is just, you know, crashing and not doing well. One word on pulmonary fibrosis. For the most part, this may not have a known trigger. Is that right?
Well, that's actually a very broad category. So there are some diseases that fall into this pulmonary fibrosis group that have a known cause. So radiation or some type of drug exposure in the past, some sort of environmental exposure. Those are common things. But there's this particularly bad diagnosis called idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, or IPF. And the idiopathic means that the underlying cause and what really kind of causes the disease to progress is not entirely known.
Right.
And those people really have a poor diagnosis and really need to be evaluated for a potential transplant as an option early on.
Right. Okay. 30 seconds. You've got all of Houston listening tonight. What's your take-home message with regard to lung health and people getting concerned about their lungs?
Well, I think that the important thing is to be kind of attuned to your body, how you're feeling, and are you, you know, and this kind of goes hand in hand in what with wellness and exercising regularly, those are the people that are going to know if there's something that's wrong,
right?
And you want to avoid exposing yourself to inhaled particles and smoke allergens.
Yeah. I mean, the bottom line, if you smoke, stop. All right. Howard, thanks very much for coming in. Dr. Howard Huang, Medical Director of the Lung Transplant Program at Houston Methodist Hospital. I have a feeling we'll have him back on soon. I'm Dr. Joe Galati. We will see you next Sunday night. Take care.
Thanks for listening today to our podcast. Don't forget, for more information, check out drjoegalati.com. Information about my book, Eating Yourself Sick, is available there, as well as our clinical practice, radio program, and social media links. We need you to be part of our tribe and community. Until we meet again, I'm Dr. Joe Galati. Ciao.